Okay, people, okay, ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gents. I was talking about this particular article last night, and we're going to continue that same conversation because what? We can't go into a new conversation. Why can't we go into a new? Because if we go into a new conversation, ladies and gentlemen, we will lose focus on what's most important. Pay attention. This is the article, Corporate Government of the United States Goes Bankrupt. This is the article I told people they should be reading things like this. You don't need to be reading this right here because go through here, no case law. No pointing at nothing. Erica Badu, y'all. Erica Badu, y'all take us into this, all right? Ladies and gentlemen, there is no case law. There's just talking. And that's the problem with most of you. You will read stuff and you'll hold on to this. Well, this person is only parroting what they've heard other people talk about. Okay? And they're making statements. That's why they sound like they're idiots in court. Okay? Idiots. Okay, now, look, I'm not knocking the person who did this. I'm knocking the people who will take this information and run with it. Oh, run, Forrest, run! Look at Forrest, run, y'all. Oh, God, Forrest, you're a great kid. Okay? You can't do that. You cannot do that. And look at it. Money changers. Money changers. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a statement from Scripture. Okay? You need to understand something. We know the following facts. Oh, he says, trust me. Okay? Trust me. Mm-hmm. Attorneys say, trust me. Why would I trust you? Ladies and gentlemen, there is a perpetuation. Perpetuation. Do you know what perpetuation means? Well, it means to move something forward. Well, technically, it means to move something forward, but it means to keep something going. Perpetual. The earth is a perpetual machine. It just keeps going. Don't need no mechanism. Ladies and gentlemen, you guys are the perpetuation of this machine. You guys are the perpetuation. What do you mean I'm the perpetuation? I'm not no keeping it going person. Really? Well, because you participate. I don't participate. You know the saying. I don't participate. Yes, you do. Okay. Because if you don't participate, that means you player hate. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm a player hater. I don't feel like participating no more. Okay? I don't feel like participating no more. I'm going to let y'all know something because y'all getting on my nerves. Many of y'all are commenting on my videos in email. F y'all. Okay? I said no. I'm going to start deleting you. Putting you, sending you straight to spam. Spam I am, ma'am I am. Okay, green eggs and spam. I'ma send you straight to spam. Okay, this is just me letting y'all know. I got people calling me at 3 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning. Ladies and gentlemen, I went to sleep. Y'all saw the clock. It was going on what time? 2 o'clock. I'm up at 7. 5 hours. Don't my voice sound like I'm up at 7? 5 hours because I ain't getting no sleep. You better believe it. Okay? Hey, JR. Jay. Hey. Thank you, Junior Jay. All right. Now, Junior Jay just took some notice of the Eon channel. So, Junior Jay, thank you. Thank you. Well, let's get back to this. We got a problem, y'all. Mary J's on my mind, y'all. And I'm not talking about that marijuana stuff, okay? I'm talking about Mary J. Blige, okay? That's who I'm talking about. Oh, you didn't think she got her name for marijuana? Mary J., hey! I love her just the same. Mary J., hey! I love her tiddle-little same. Oh, he's old Mary J. Yeah, whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay, marijuana, y'all. The song was about marijuana. I know you knew that, but some of the new folks didn't know that Rick James was singing about marijuana. I talked about him smoking that 18-inch blunt. Oh, now it's 18 inches, huh? That's right. It's just like the Big Fish. Got on stage and just smoked it. When it was illegal, he was sitting up there on stage doing something illegal, smoking it and getting arrested for it. That's right, police showing up and trying to arrest him. Okay? Now, let me let y'all know. Somebody just told me that they're in the UK and PayPal got access to their account. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to let y'all know, although I care about your personal problems, I don't give a f- okay? I got problems of my own. I ain't got time to be worrying about what's going on with y'all. I'm trying to warn y'all about what's going on with the nation. And y'all sitting up here telling me about y'all personal stuff. Stop it. Just stop it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and let's talk about what this video is about. We're going to do some little talking right here. Current banking emergency. Question mark. Nah. We got to do 2017, y'all. 2017. 2008. That's what we're going to do. 2008, the financial meltdown. The Emergency Economic Stabilization Act of 2008. You see, the emergency is still ongoing. Oh, look, subprime mortgage crisis. There's another crisis in the United States as discussed by the Secretary of the Treasury. They keep doing these emergencies, ladies and gentlemen. All right, now how do you handle the emergency? Well, what you need to understand is, oh, I'm sorry, Your Honor. What, they want to take my apartment? They want to take my house? They want to kick me out? Well, they can't do so. There's a moratorium. There's a complete moratorium in the United States. There's no more collecting on debts. That's what the Gold Repeal Act was all about. And that's what the proclamations of President Roosevelt was about. You know, Proclamation 2039 and 2040, where he declared a banking holiday. And where in 1976, the United States Senate Committee ruled that that was still extant. Now, you know, Your Honor, extant is a legalese word. Extant means still ongoing, still existing, currently existing. So because we're still in a banking holiday, I'm sorry, you don't have the jurisdiction, Your Honor. No, because if you had the jurisdiction, that means that you would have asked me, did I contact the Federal Reserve? Pay attention. Did I contact the Federal Reserve and ask them, since we're still in a banking emergency and still, since we're using only emergency currency, which have no value because Federal Reserve notes have no value in and of themselves, as documented by the United States Treasury, in their news press in 2011, then I would have been told how to get access to my account because it would be, Your Honor, you listening? No, wake up. This is my turn to talk right now. I'm talking about your secrets, your business. Okay, since the Federal Reserve issues emergency currency, and because we're under the banking holiday and the emergency that extends from 1933 until present, since we're still in that same emergency and the Federal Reserve issues emergency currency, that means that they would have had to have set up an account for all of the people in the United States, all of the naturally born individuals of the United States. They'd have to set up an account for them because they're issuing emergency currency, and they would have to issue that currency to me upon request. So where do I go to get my currency? Where I go to get my stipend? Where are they holding my funds at, Your Honor? I know it ain't, because I have to be naturally born in the United States, it has to be attributed to the birth certificate, so that must be one of the forms of identification. And because Social Security was created at the same time, that was there to secure those funds. So where is my Social Security account and my Federal Reserve account? Huh? Because they got to create an account because they had to give this emergency currency out to people, and they had to have some way of keeping track who they were giving it out to and which person had received it and had not received it, because it's emergency currency, you know. So it was given out on an emergency basis. It's just like when you have an emergency, like a hurricane, you know, like they had Hurricane Maria, the military comes out there and they give out emergency supplies. So where's my emergency supply currency? Because it's emergency currency, Your Honor. Mister? Oh, no. I said Your Honor. You can't call a female Your Honor because Your Honor has a masculine tone. Masculine word. Come on now. You can't call a female a masculine person, okay?
Unless she really wants to be masculine. You know what I'm saying?
So, Mister? Contempt? Calling you Mister? Well, you be calling me Mr. all the time. You refer to me as Mr. Why can't I call you Mr.? My name ain't Mr. Mr. ain't on none of my IDs. Go ahead, look at any of my IDs. You don't see Mr. nowhere. They don't say Mr. such and such nowhere on any of my identification. And you keep calling me Mr. So why can't I call you Mr.? Wait, 6 months? No, you can't do that to me. No, I apologize. I'm sorry. All right then. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the problem with people. Everybody says they're doing their research, but they're not understanding the situation. They put into existence this thing called emergency. And like I said, they keep announcing these emergencies. They've been announcing it since 1933. National emergencies, which makes it the same mother thing. Emergency currency. Oh, you're going to like the next one I look up. Emergency roadside assistance. Nobody asked for emergency roadside assistance. And we're not talking about emergency circulating notes. That is not what we're looking for. We're Nugeld. German for emergency money, necessary money. Refers to money issued by an institution at a time of economic and political crisis. Well, look at that. We done found a website, Wikipedia. Oh, God. Well, you call it Wikipedia. Oh, look, emergency notes. Currency for sale. Collector's corner. Interesting. That was World War II emergency notes.
Emergency World War II currency for the Hawaiian.
Emergency currency. So it is not a term that they're unfamiliar with. Okay? And they told you that this is throughout the whole world. So
Filipino, Victor notes, and emergency war currency, lot number, blah, blah, blah.
Every country who joined in that bankruptcy, because you got to admit, we keep talking about the Americans having their bankruptcy. It was all of those nations coming together at those meetings held at the Geneva, Switzerland. Can't call them Geneva Conventions because there were no conventions back then. These were world leaders meeting under the League of Nations. Let's do that. World leaders meet at Geneva, Switzerland, 1929. Forgot my question mark. Need my question mark, y'all.
World leaders meet at Geneva, Switzerland, 1939.
History Dictionary
of the Great Depression,
1929 to 1940. Ladies and gentlemen, the Great Depression did not end in 1940. Because World War II was going on in 1940, which means it wouldn't have ended until 1945. Uh-oh, it's still going on because it's a current emergency. So the Great Depression never ended, if you look at the logic of these idiots. Do you get it? Do you understand? Okay.
In 1917, Geneva was ranked the world's 15th most important financial center.
Ain't that something? Now, you know what I'm thinking? I'm thinking in World War II, yeah, China was involved. So why did it take them so long to come into the so-called capitalism? Because with this new world currency, the United States had created a new way of dealing with the world currency. Okay? 1929 world leaders may refer to the sovereigns in 1929.
List of sovereign states in 1929.
Nope. World War II. See, Switzerland, World War I. I didn't ask no question about World War I. I asked about world leaders. And I say Geneva, Switzerland, 1929. Meet in Geneva, Switzerland, 1929. That's what I'm looking for. Okay. Let's do meet. M-E-E-T. Not that stuff you eat, people. Okay. we got going on in the background, y'all, a little bit of Deborah Cox. She's singing a song about up and down. No, it ain't what you think. This is Deborah, y'all. Deborah's a clean girl, y'all. All right? Yeah, I know. Anyway,
A Clashing of the Souls, John Hope and Dilemma of Africa.
We're not talking about no dilemma in Africa, but it says, YMCA World Committee meeting in Geneva, Switzerland, early in 1929. Excuse me? I'm not talking about no YMCA. This ain't no village people. God, what's wrong with y'all? Okay. That is my girl, Deborah Cox.
Up and down, in and out.
Sorry. This is Deborah Cox, ladies and gentlemen. The song is called Up and Down, and she does an alright job. Herbert Huber had an admirable reservoir of experience. International affairs when he became president in March 1929. Okay. He had traveled the world extensively as a mining engineer, served on President Wilson's delegation of peace talks at the end of World War I because they established the League of Nations. Of course they would bring Hoover in there since he was on the delegation of peace talks. Of course they would bring him into those meetings in Geneva, Switzerland. He had no American provincial. He was no American provincial. Anyway, as President Hoover's foreign policies were conditioned by the Great Depression, indeed, by the fall of 1930, Hoover was blaming Americans' economic malaise on international and especially European economic realities. As a result, he looked increasingly for ways to improve the international economy as the Depression deepened. That's right, 1929 is when they say it started, but it didn't. It started before he came in office. And I guarantee you, go back and do the history. I didn't live back then, and ladies and gentlemen, I have not done the research on this. But I guarantee you, do the history. That was one of the platforms that he pledged on when he became president, was the current economic situation in America. Because people were starting to lose jobs. Inflation was starting to have a grip. So I guarantee you, that was one of the reasons why he was voting in the office, and one of the reasons why he was not chosen to remain in office. Because they had to put in Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Why? Because Hoover would not have approved the plans that they were asking for. See, at the same time, Hoover pushed for disarmament treaties. Although American relations with countries such as South and Central America and confronted Japanese aggression in China. Okay? Hoover's most important foreign policy advisor was Secretary of State Henry Stimson. Stimson's previous experience in federal government and Secretary of War for President Taft, oh God, he must have been really old, and as Governor General of the Philippine Islands from 1928 to 1929, well, he wasn't there very long, was he? Made him the ideal choice for the head of the Department of State. Really? He's only there for a year and you want to make him the head of state. And that's like making John Kerry a Secretary of State. That's just ceremonial. I'll go back and look at John Kerry, y'all. It was only ceremonial, all the junk that idiot did.
Hoover's attempt in 1929-1930 to enact tariffs reform quickly emerged as a major domestic policy and political issue.
Well, ain't that something? Like I told you. He came in trying to change things, and they said, oh no, we doing this, we doing that. And when he realized, what he realized is that they were trying to take over. Who was trying to take over? The finances, the people who control the finances of the world. What do you mean? What? Well, hold on. Let me show you. I told you I didn't read this, but I know he came in on this issue of finances.
The market crash in October 1929.
Yeah, that's how he came into office, ladies and gentlemen. Moreover,
weakened
an already shaky global economy, economic order. Ladies and gentlemen, weakened and already shaky. You need to understand. No, wait a minute. I just listened to this song last night. This is my girl, Patti LaBelle, featuring Michael. We just listened to that. We're going to listen to Love. L-O-V-E, Love, by Al Green. Okay? That's who's going to play in my background. Al Green, tell us about Love. He started to write this song, y'all. Okay, now many of y'all think y'all know this stuff, so y'all just sit back because we're going to go for a ride because I'm only telling you what I assume to know. It says already shaky global economic order. That's how he became president. But remember, already shaky global economic order, which means the depression did not start in 29. This was as a result of the already shaky global economic order. This was the banks doing this. It didn't crash. They crashed the system by pulling the money out of the system.
Following World War I, the United States emerged as the
linchpin of the world economy.
Germany depended upon American loans to pay its Great War reparations to France and Britain, which owed the United States for the loans they received during the war. The American dollar made these delicate financial arrangements possible, but those dollars disappeared when the Great Crash. Excuse me. It's with the Great Crash. But ladies and gentlemen, I told you, when those dollars disappeared, I didn't write this. They took the money out of the system.
And explain this feeling. Can't you see that salvation is real? I would give my life for the glory, just to be able to tell the story about love.
Sorry. Okay? As a result, an already sluggish world economy slowed further. See, it was already slowing. In the summer of 1931, German banks defaulted on their reparation payment. Ladies and gentlemen, reparations after World War I, the nations got together with the League of Nations, which was just created by Woodrow Wilson, and they imposed these tariffs, these reparations, these penalties on Germany. Okay? And because the money the Germans were using to pay back everybody was based on the world reserve currency, which was at the time backed by gold, well, they had no more access to the gold because nobody was giving them gold. Okay? This is what the nations do. You get into a war, the nations make you agree to not do this and not do that, and they hit you with these tariffs. Tariffs. I don't know who this is. This is Anthony Hamilton? Anthony, that's you talking. I don't want to hear you talking. We're going to hear about... Y'all know who this is?
How's everybody feeling out there tonight? Ladies and gentlemen, without no further ado, I'd like to introduce to you the original entertainer,
Doug E. Fresh! Get Fresh Crew!
Alright, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, if y'all didn't know, that's Dougie and the Get Fresh Crew. This is the word, Your Honor, extant. It means active, alive. The Congress said the law was still extant. And that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to pull that quote. No, wait a minute. I can't pull it from here. I'm going to pull it, and we're going to put it here. Okay, so let's
minimize. Let's capitalize. And let's... We're going to find.
Oh, no, it's not here. It's in the other one. I got to open up the other one. Sorry, y'all. I should have had it already open, but, you know, I don't know. I, you know.
Dougie Fresh, the Get Fresh crew, Chill Will, Barry B, and Ricky D, and my name is the original human beatbox, the entertainer, Doug E. Fresh. You don't know that Dana Dane used to be with Dougie Fresh and the Get Fresh crew. Those of you who know who Dana Dane is, this is me letting y'all know that that's the history of rap. I just hit open. How come it didn't open?
Open.
Uh-oh. No, I don't want to save. I want to open. My mouth's been jumping lately. It's been kind of jumpy. I don't know why. I said open. Oh, I opened the wrong one. I gotta open the right one, y'all. U.S. bankruptcy. This document right here. I opened the wrong document. I am so sorry. Waiting for nothing to happen. Oh, you just sitting back waiting for nothing to happen. So let's do our word extent. We're going to have at least E-X-T-A-N-T. Let's look for extent. Why are you looking for extent?
Because as Brother Nathan said, they were still extent. Okay, let's do this. Hold up. Let's do copy. Okay.
Chill Will! Chill Will! Chill Will!
Well, that's what he's saying. Okay. And we go here. And we go all the way back up here. And we got our Geneva, Switzerland junk. We go back there. We go Control V. And we go Enter. Enter.
Fixed text 95753. Internet Archive.
Okay. The War of Powers Act of 1933. I don't want to read that article. I want to read the issue. Look. The act was expanded to deal with the peacetime national emergency of 1933. No, the act was not expanded to deal with peacetime. The act was expanded to deal with the people because they knew the people would not go for what they were doing. You see, everybody thinks the people accepted this national emergency. They did not. It was force-fed upon them. Okay? Now, see, this thing's gun control, Second Amendment. Nobody cares about the gun control and Second Amendment. What I'm looking for is the extantness.
ProfessionalSoldiers.com. Professional soldiers, emergency, but also the proclamation of President Truman and the two by President Nixon were extant. Technically, the National Emergencies Act did not repeal.
Why is this saying this? Because I thought it was that idiot, that lawyer whom I was showing you. This means this is somebody congressional. Yeah, this is somebody copying what this lawyer said. But what I need is what the actual Senate said. So let's not do what the lawyer said. Let's do what the Senate said. Okay? So that's one. Oh, it's eight times. This is Jeffrey Osborne. Jeffrey, I love you, but I don't love that part of you, okay? No, we're going to go to... No, not you, Jeffrey. I want Michael. Uh-oh. Can't do that one either. No, Sean Paul. Hey! Y'all know about Rufus and Shaka?
I would love you anyway. Even if you cannot stay.
Okay. Okay, that's why it was eight. Because that's me adding that into the document. So we're going to go to not there. Not there. Here. Sorry about that. It's early in the morning, y'all. I mean, early in the morning. Y'all know what it is. I don't usually wake up until 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning, and so it's just so early. Sorry, there's a there's a Ray Charles song where he's talking like that, and it's on my mind. Ray Charles, that's my boy, y'all. You know, just Ray old Charles. You know, he's just this Ray Charles. You know. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, let's look for what I need to look for.
Wish you were my mother. But you,
I didn't ask you to go there. I don't even know how you got there. I don't know how you got there. Sitting up there opening up my emails. I didn't ask you to open that up. Hold on, let's do this. There you go. Whew. Let's do that.
The fixed text of the National Emergency Act. Okay, ladies and gentlemen,
I want the fixed text. Do you know why I want the fixed text? Because I want to take this fixed text right here. Because it's a Senate report. 94th Congress, second session, Senate report, number 222, or whatever it is. Don't care about the number, okay, y'all? It just don't matter. Okay, this is the Committee of Government Operations and the Special Committee of National Emergency and Delegated Emergency Powers of the United States Senate, November 1976. This is their committee print. National Emergency Act, and it's Public Law 94-412. Okay, so Congress officially recognized the act as being extant, and we, oh God, this is a lot of words, y'all, but we want to find the word extant in this actual text, because this is the actual text of the public law, National Emergencies. Now, remember, we found that it did not repeal, copy,
love me now or I'll go crazy.
Sorry, that's my girl, Shaka. Love me not. You know what? I have not heard a single interview by Shaka regarding our friend, Prince. Doesn't mean we need to hear, because she doesn't have to speak out. But I'm just saying, I have not heard anything from the young lady. No pictures, no nothing. And they were very, 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 very good friends. Uh-oh. Hold on. The word extant does not appear in the act. It must appear in the notes, because I just searched for the word in the notes. So let's do 2040. You know, life is funny when you look at it. Oh, Proclamation 2040 is the same zip code as Washington, D.C.? Oh, God. If you get anything out of life, gotta put up with some times of strife. Wait, let's do this. I don't think you know how. Uh-oh. How did I get that right there? Okay, we don't have emergency currency in this act. This one is only talking about the powers of president. So emergency powers that the president would have, because they wanted to ring in the president in 1976. Why? Because Lincoln had just issued a couple of proclamations that affected others. And so the Senate wanted to put a little clarity on that. But let's see. What is the... Let's do... 95B. Nope, don't have 95B. Let's put 95. Nope, don't have 95B. Let's do 12 USC. Nope, 12 USC is not in here. So this act did not deal primarily with that, but let's see. R-O-O-S-E-V-E-L-T. Okay. The next National Emergency Proclamation issued 48-Stat-1689 by President Roosevelt on March 6th. This is where you get the 40-39. 48-Stat. We gotta look it up, y'all. So we're going to copy. Sorry, this is how you do research, people. You don't just do research based on what somebody's putting on video. You have to delve into the information. Okay, we're going to do paste and search. Because that's the way I feel about you. Ooh. Okay, President Emergency Powers, the so-called War Powers Act. Okay, this guy actually puts that, the proclamation... 2039, just like I told you. That's the actual stat for Proclamation 2039. Okay, so I'm looking for the actual stat. I don't see it, y'all. Emergency Banking Relief Act. See, and Uh-oh. Ooh! Please, please! Okay, and we're gonna finish talking about that because we gotta read this to find out what they say. I put banking holiday. I didn't put bank holiday. Okay, we're gonna... Remember, this is the actual committee act that we're talking about. So we're gonna talk about it in a minute, y'all. We're gonna bring this back. Dangers that he put you through. Think it over. Think it over, girl. Cause that's the way I feel about you. Emergency Banking Relief Act. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what he introduced in the first place. Was that stat, 48 stat, 1689. Okay? But the thing about it, I'm not pulling it up. And I need to pull it up because it is the stat that they didn't refer to it in the articles by the so-called morons. This is... No, because that'll be the same article. That's why it's in archive.org. Okay, because remember when those guys in archive.org and the guys at freedom-school and others were bringing this information up, everybody made them out to be like they were crazy, like they didn't know what they were talking about. And look, this article right here, Ending Emergency Government. Now, this was a 1989 Utah Supreme Court decision. I got to, y'all, because this right here will be primo. And then we're going to do this PDF, y'all, because we need the PDF, because we need to find out who's talking. Senator Frank Church. You guys remember Church, don't you? It had a lot to do with finances. Wait. This looks like it might not be... No, because I didn't want to listen to Eve, but this is Keith Sweat. No, I don't feel like listening to I Wanna. Okay. Nah, gotta get my music, y'all. This is coming from where I'm from. Y'all know Anthony Hamilton. My concern is to end emergency government, which the United States has practiced since March 9, 1933, to establish an orderly procedure for handling inevitable emergency situations. This is an issue of importance to our common future and the future well-being of our constitutional system of government. Why is it an important thing for the well-being of our Constitution? Why? Because it's suspended powers. Okay? The emergency. Remember, if the emergency had ended... Wait. This is Senator
Church.
Okay? Senator
Frank Church.
Ending emergency government. Let's go all the way down to the bottom because I need to find out when this was written. Well, we see he's quoting a law from 1965, so I know this is going to be written around the 70s. 1975, what'd I tell you? Okay, Senator Church, he says the ongoing emergency. He said the continuation of the emergency. Don't believe me? My concern is to end emergency government, which the United States has practiced since March 9, 1933. You want to download this? I'm going to tell you where to download it. Talking about love. Ending emergency government is what it's called. The University of
Akron.
Okay?
By Frank Church.
Strong man breaking him down to his knees. You know what? I am letting you all know that I'm very glad that Anthony Hamilton has finally got his due. Sitting up there helping everybody and their grandmama with their stuff, and they finally recognize Anthony Hamilton. All right, don't send me no comments about no Anthony Hamilton because you're going to get that finger to sit on and spin with. Okay, let's go. This is an issue of importance to our common future and the future well-being of our constitutional system of government. There are now, in effect, four presidential
proclaimed states of national emergency. There are now in effect 4 presidential proclaimed state of emergency. The national emergency declared by President Roosevelt in 1933 to deal with the Great Depression, number 2, we're going to go there, and the national emergency proclaimed by President Truman on December 1950 during the Korean conflict. Okay? I want y'all to understand. Whoa, wait a minute. How did I lose that? Where'd it go? Where'd it go? Don't know how I lost it, y'all. That's this mouse thing. All right, let's do. March 9th, 1933. Okay, here's the stat right here. Okay, this is the act. Okay, this is the emergency. The senator, the honorable senator, the gentleman senator, Mr. Church was speaking about. Oh, no, we need this article. We can't let this article go to waste. Okay, just save. Don't ask me no question. A few days after taking office in 1933, President Roosevelt declared a bank holiday and proclaimed that the heavy, unwarranted withdrawal of gold and currency from banking institutions for the purpose of hoarding, that's what they were withdrawing it for, they wanted to hoard it, and continuous and increasing extensive speculation activities abroad in foreign exchange resulted in severe drains on the nation's stock of gold and have created a national emergency proclamation 2039 stat 48.1689 March 6, 1933. Okay? Just want to make sure y'all know that I'm not just talking out the side of my neck when I said I done traced it. I can prove how it all got started, that we're still in a national emergency. This means that a majority of the American people have lived all their lives under emergency rule.
Uh-oh, suspension of the Constitution. We're still in emergency rule, y'all. If it's emergency rule and they're issuing emergency currency, told you to focus on the word emergency. Your Honor, if emergency is still going on, that means that we have a moratorium and a stay. Since my constitutional rights have been placed on hold, the right to property is pivotal. I said pivotal. So since we're still in an emergency, where's my emergency currency? If they give me my emergency currency, I can pay my emergency bills under this emergency that we're currently under with my emergency currency. Yeah, currently and currency, two different words, but similar sounding. Okay, shut up. But Your Honor, contempt. Why are you gonna put me in contempt again, mister? I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, are you understanding what's being said here? We're still in an emergency.
For 41 years, this was around 1970. 1933 plus 40 is 1973. Plus 1 is 1974.
He wrote this in 1975, or published in 1975. For 41 years, protections and procedures guaranteed by the Constitution have, in varying degrees, been abridged by executive directives that derive from presidential proclaimed states of emergencies.
Notice what he says. I summon all citizens to make a united effort for the security and well-being of our beloved country. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not just something a few people were talking about, but most of you do not know about this because this right here was hidden from you. And they keep making people sound like they crazy. And this is Harry Truman who was saying that he wants the people to recognize what's going on and preserve their country. Okay? That's why he brought forth his proclamations. Declaration of National Emergency by the President of the United States of America. A proclamation, whereas certain employees of the Postal Service are engaged in an unlawful work of sabotage. No, it's not sabotage, it's stoppage. which has prevented the delivery of mails, that's when they were going on a strike, and the discharge of their postal functions in various parts of the United States, and whereas, as a result of such unlawful work stoppage, the performance of critical governmental and private functions, such as the processing of men into the armed forces of the United States of America, and the transmitting of tax refunds, and the receipt of tax collections, and the transmitting of Social Security and welfare payments, and the conduct of numerous and important commercial transactions has wholly ceased or is seriously impeded, and whereas the continuance of such work stoppage with its attendant consequences will impair the ability of this nation to carry out its obligations abroad and will cripple and halt the official and commercial intercourse.
Oh God, they're having sex.
Which is essential for the conduct of domestic business. Now, therefore, I, Richard Nixon, am not a crook, President of the United States of America, pursuant to the powers vested in me by the Constitution and laws of the United States. The reason why he says it's as a result of the laws of the Constitution of the United States is so that he can let the Congress and the, pay attention, the Supreme Court know that they can't do anything. They can't touch this. Dun, 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 dun. Dun-dun, can't touch this. I'm not a crook. Okay?
It says, by the provisions of Section 673 of Title 10 of the United States Code, do hereby declare a state of national emergency and direct the Secretary of Defense to take such actions as he deems necessary to carry out the provision of Section 673 in order that the laws of the United States pertaining to the Post Office Department may be executed in accordance with their terms.
Ladies and gentlemen, I need you guys to understand what what Nixon did on this day. He called in the Secretary of Defense. He used his war powers because he declared a national emergency. And what did he do? He stated, look, he says the armed forces of the United States. He stated that it was impairing the United States functions and was a threat.
Woke up and daddy was stoned.
And he didn't tell me nothing. Frontin' in the hood, try to be somebody. So empty. Something. I'm trying to be good. Trying to keep from trouble.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is what you all need to understand. You all need to get this. Because many of you are not going to get this. You cannot just walk out there and start telling this to people because they won't get this. You can't put together a paper explaining this to people because they won't get this. You see how long it's took me to be able to put together the pieces and be able to show you this so that you can see it articulated. It was 2 hours yesterday, and now we're almost another hour of explaining this. Okay? The emergencies are still going on. The Senate recognizes the emergencies are still going on. Okay? And let's go down. We're not worried about these proclamations. I am more in... Okay. It is important to note that the word emergency is not found in the Constitution. The authority to deal with a crisis situation must be derived from express provisions of the Constitution. Now, he says, let's go to number 7 and check that out. And I like the way he's bringing this up. Now, look, it says, it is also important to look to the definition of emergency, emergencies, and the presidency. Here and after cited as Strom, it states, emergency is defined as an unforeseen combination of circumstances or a resulting state that calls for immediate action. Webster's International Dictionary of English Language. I'm using legalese, Senator. You know that. You're a lawyer. It is characterized by the urgency and relative and frequency of occurrence and is equivalent to a public calamity resulting by fire, flood, or like disaster, not reasonably subject to anticipation. Home Building and Loan Association versus Braisdale, United States Supreme Court. And Professor Edward S. Corwin explains emergency conditions as those which have not attained enough stability or recurrency to admit they're being dealt with
according to rule. President office and power. Okay? But he told us to look at United States Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, and Home Building Association, which we just read right there. Okay? Let's go back up to that because he was explaining emergency. Emergency does not create power. Emergency does not increase granted power or remove or diminish restrictions imposed upon powers granted or reserved. The Constitution was adopted in a period of grave emergency. Its grants of powers to the federal government and its limitation of powers of the state were determined in light of emergency, and they are not altered by emergency. That's what the Supreme Court said. That's why he, in number 8, he focuses on that case by the Supreme Court. This case right here. Okay? But you all need to know. See, Albert Strum has reviewed the history of the exercise of presidential emergency power and have come to the conclusion that although the legal sources of presidential emergency power are the Constitution and congressional delegation, yes, they have to go together, the extent of their invocation and use is also contingent upon the personal conception which is incumbent of the presidential office has of the presidency and the premises upon which he interprets its legal powers. Needless to say, the history of our nation reflects that the role conception of the various presidents has varied. Relatedly, it is no coincidence that the exercise of presidential emergency powers can be correlated to these overall conceptions. Ladies and gentlemen, what you need to understand is in 1976, they didn't appreciate the fact that the president would act with his war powers and do something such as order the postal service to continue working, to make it illegal for them to ever go on strike or for them ever to get unionized like other unions have gotten unionized. Euthanized? Are you saying euthanized? The postal service is euthanized? They should be, shouldn't they? Okay. Judicial review of emergency government. If we began with the premise that the emergency does not create or enlarge constitutional powers, it is noteworthy to mention that great discretion has been granted the executive branch to determine the nature and the duration of the remedy of the crisis situation. On April 4, 1942, the issuance by President Truman of Executive Order 10340 directing the seizure of the steel industry resulted in a pre-examination of the United States Supreme Court of the role of the branches of government in an emergency situation. The steel companies conceded the existence of broad emergency powers, but argued that it was the role of Congress to legislate appropriately and specifically to protect the nation from threatening disaster. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to keep going on and on with this article because I never read it, but I'm showing you that at the time of 1976, it was understood that the emergency that was created by President Franklin Delano Roosevelt was still an emergency, still going on. The emergency was still going on. So that means that we still got emergency currency. And let's do B-A-N-K-H-O-L-I-D-A-Y. Anthony, you're getting on my nerves right now. Okay, I like you, Anthony, but you're getting on my nerves. Alright. Oh God, no. Ain't no way in the world I'm gonna be playing no Britney Tears. Whew. Lord have mercy. Hey. Uh-oh, we gotta play this. Uh-oh, it didn't take me to Mariah. Oh, I was let's take you off of, ladies and gentlemen, it was on Mix, and I don't want Mix. I don't want Shuffle. Uh-oh, gotta put it on. It's gonna go in order. Okay. Nah, we ain't doing that one. Nope, they ain't doing that one.
Dougie Fresh and the Plane. If y'all never heard this song before, by Dougie Fresh. This is Dougie Fresh and the Plane.
Boss, the plane, the plane.
It's a simple song, but I like it. It's just that simple. It's a simple song. Ladies and gentlemen, I can't stay here. I got some things that I got to go do, so I can't stay here doing this video because I got things that I got to go do. So I apologize. But during the Civil War period, there were lots of emergency money issues. Okay? Learn how emergency currency such as gold. Gold is not emergency currency, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, they specifically spoke about emergency currency. There is no definition in the Constitution for emergency currency. Go ahead and look up. Just any one of you guys who ever want to do anything, look up emergency currency. Remember, like he said, there's nothing in the Constitution that talks about an emergency. Okay? It wasn't put there. So they created it. That's why Roosevelt used the war powers, and they used that stupid statute, the Banking Act, Trading with the Enemies Act, to bring forth this emergency. Thus, Emergency Banking Act, the Emergency Economic Banking Relief Act of 1933. Ladies and gentlemen, we're still in the emergency. So if it were me, I'm calling the Social Security Administration and I'm asking them about the current emergency. We're still under emergency rule. And because we're under emergency rule and because we're using emergency currency, where is your access to the emergency currency? You have bills to pay. And if there's emergency currency, who is overseeing my account concerning this emergency currency? In other words, who is debiting out the emergency currency? Now you find a way to articulate that and put that in a proper format, and I believe you might be able to better get it. Because remember, as I said, if they're going to release emergency currency into the system, hold on, EMERGENCY, emergency currency. Federal Reserve notes is the emergency currency permitted under the proclamation. Now, I did not write this. Permitted under the proclamation for the current emergency and the Emergency Banking Relief Act of 1933. And as long as they are still in circulation, this is further proof to concur with the Senate of 1976 that the banking holiday and the national emergency still exists. Okay? Oh, I'm sorry, I did write this. This is me adding this. So, I mean, it almost sounded like somebody else wrote it, didn't it? But I wrote that. I added that because this is the individual's, the little document I told you I was going to go over with you guys later to show you how I'm dealing with this with the courts, okay? Since the proclamation by Roosevelt declared a banking holiday, there has been no succeeding proclamation to repeal that presidential declared order proclamation. We are still in a banking emergency, a banking holiday using emergency currency, which means during that emergency, this body does not have statutory authority to proceed in the matters involving properties in America. Because all properties are owned by the government as a result of the emergency. They have seized all your property to deal with the emergency. And they're claiming it was an emergency, ladies and gentlemen. That's why we looked at the word extant, meaning a law that still is active. A law that still exists. Something that still exists. The Senate ruled that the law was still extant. All right? So this is just me going ahead and giving you guys some further information on whether or not you need to be paying attention. Sorry, these videos are not going to be given the title to make everybody aware, because this is designed for those of you who are truly interested, those of you who are truly going to do some research, those of you who truly want to know what's going on. They did a military coup in 1933, and Congress was involved. Why? Because the president held them by the neck. He had just come into office, and the first thing he does is he makes Congress come together. And the first thing they do, without missing a beat, remember, he just became president on the 3rd of March. And Congress passed this act on the 9th of March. He just came into office, and the first thing he does is issues military orders. And Congress supports that those military orders and bring all of you into this. Okay? This was all a plan, people. So when you think these presidents are placed in office because
they are voted in by the people,
please stop that. These people are placed in office because they are placed in office. This is what they do. Okay, result 9 of 10. So, there we go. We back up to number 1. Okay, so we see Roosevelt papers admit the Emergency Banking Act made it possible to issue emergency currency, which was based on the assets of the bank, rather than upon the gold and silver. Ladies and gentlemen, it allowed them to issue emergency currency that was supposed to be backed by the banks. That was Federal Reserve bank notes. Okay, not Federal Reserve notes. There is nothing in the statute that speaks to Federal Reserve notes. It speaks specifically about Federal Reserve bank notes and circulating notes. You don't believe me? Here's part of the statute here. And circulating notes in blank is what the Treasury was to issue for the junk that the Federal Reserve was giving them, which had to be backed by the assets of the bank. Okay? We put that here. Okay? It says in the form of Federal Reserve bank notes, which could be based on a sound assets owned by the banks. This is the Roosevelt papers, never authorizing Federal Reserve notes. Only authorizing Federal Reserve bank notes. Look at that junk you have in your pocket. That is not Federal Reserve bank notes. That's Federal Reserve notes. Wondering if actions speak louder than words. So as we become one, you feel no pain. Our bodies so... I can't play that part. It's like a mystery for the world to see, because only you and me, you know our destiny. You might think I'm crazy or just too deep or too wild or too strong or too cold. There you go. So you may feel about me inside. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride on the plane. So high, so high. The song is called The Plane, ladies and gentlemen. This was Dougie Fresh
and the Get Fresh Crew,
because he's the greatest entertainer. All right. Let's go and let you guys know, let you get to your day. You guys have all been wondering how to get access to your accounts. Well, now you know what type of an account it is. Now you know what's actually going on behind the scene. Now you know that there's an emergency. These videos are designed to help you understand where you stand. Because if you don't know what's going on, you will not be able to articulate it. And some of you are trying to articulate in the worst way. Okay? Some of you think you got it going on. Some of you think you understand. Some of you think you know. And you don't know nothing. And that's what you sound like. Okay? Tell them, Ray. That's Ray Charles, y'all. All right. So with that being said, ladies and gentlemen, now that you know this, now you can move forward in going about trying to resolve this. Now that you know this, now you can move forward in trying to resolve this. There is no money. We've been telling you that from the very beginning. They're using what's called currency. There is no money. They are using currency. And they're not just using any currency. They're using currency that's not backed by anything. We're going to do that one more time, because y'all need to understand that, because y'all don't get it. The Treasury at its own website, let you know this is the Treasury website. The Treasury at its own website says Federal Reserve notes are not redeemable in gold, silver, or any other commodity, and receive no backing by anything. And I told you, there is no period here. This is on the Treasury website. This has been the case since 1933, since the proclamations. Okay? The notes have no value in themselves. Don't worry about the buts.
because if they have no value, that is exactly the point. They are worthless. It is currency. It is not money. Okay? Now, if you want to understand what I mean by it's currency, it's not money, in the preceding paragraph, they talk about if Congress has specified the Federal Reserve banks must hold collateral equal to the value of the Federal Reserve bank notes, not the Federal Reserve notes. They have not said anything about Federal Reserve notes that the bank receives. This collateral is chiefly gold certificates and United States security. This provides backing for the notes issued. No, our economy is backed by mortgages. What do you mean our economy is backed by mortgages? Oh, come on, guys. You don't remember me showing you? Okay, let's go here. Let's do it this way. Federal Housing Administration, the largest mortgager in the world. Ensure didn't mean to do that. Some of you guys only thought Ray Charles did the singing. Okay. This is called The Ray. And you don't hear Mr. Ray doing nothing but playing in the background on the piano, okay? He did more than sing, y'all. Now, let's go here. Because I want to tell y'all how the economy functions. Because many of y'all don't get it. Pay attention. The Federal Housing Administration, generally known as FHA, provides mortgage insurance for loans made by the FHA-approved lenders throughout the United States and its territories. FHA insures mortgages on single-family and multifamily homes, including manufactured homes, hospitals. It is the largest insurer of mortgages in the world, insuring 38 million properties, over 38 million properties since its inception in 1934. Remember, over 38 million. It's a lot more than that. They just put over, so it includes that, so that you can't accuse them of lying. Ladies and gentlemen, people say, well, my home, the FHA, I called them, and they say my home, it's not an FHA loan. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not going to play the show, okay? We can get in a lot of trouble playing this song, okay? We can get a lot of trouble playing... Oh, my God! Oh, my God! We're not going to play that song, well, because that's the original. And, ladies and gentlemen, this is Patti LaBelle. That spirit is in it. It's what it's called. I didn't ask you. Vooz, what are you doing popping up? I didn't pick you. Close. Exit Vooz. Vooz is a pretty good program. If you don't know who Vooz is, you better learn. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, let me make sure before we get off of this video that you guys understand what's going on. The entire economy is backed by insurance of mortgages. That's why the mortgage crisis was so devastating. Because remember, it's a mortgage on all of the homes in the United States. Wait, hold on. So that you guys understand.
The money will be worth 100 cents on the dollar because it is backed by the credit of the people of the nation, and it represents a mortgage on all the homes and other property of the people of the United of the nation. This is 1933. It represents a mortgage on the homes and the people. Okay? That's what makes the economy go round. You people need to understand that. That's why Afghanistan was so important, because they needed those people. They needed to give them last names and birth certificates. Okay?
Oh, no, they're just doing that to educate the Muslim girls because the Muslim girls don't get to go to school. What the...
Stop listening to that bull, okay, people? That nation, the nation of Muslims, the nation of Islamic faith, could not have progressed to where it is if they kept their women barefoot and pregnant. Or they make them wear veils over their faces. Because that's a tradition. The same as in America, women put on makeup to make themselves look like creatures of the night. Sorry, some women actually wear makeup very good.
She wears it very good, Your Honor.
But other women put that junk on their face and they think they're looking beautiful and they look horrible. And then you got some women, man, they don't need to put makeup on to save nobody's life because they are already beautiful without makeup. Okay? So we have traditions, we have culture. The Islamic faith, the Islamic people, the Muslims have not only culture, history, but they have their beliefs that everybody wants to impose their opinion on. You people don't have the right to do that. If that's the way they live, you don't get to go over there and change the way they live. I mean, look at what they did in Africa. They went over there and changed the way they live and then brought them over here and tried to force a culture on them. You can't force your culture on anyone. Okay, ladies and gentlemen? So stop it. So please understand that this new currency, the money, this so-called emergency currency will be worth 100 cents on the dollar. Remember, every dollar is equal because it is backed by the credit of the nation. Credit of the nation. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not backed by the credit of the nation. It's supposed to be backed by the money. But they were saying it was backed by the full faith and credit because the government was behind the issuance of this new emergency currency. Because they were partaking in the fruits of their labor. It is military. The proclamations were military and they're still in effect. And they exercise control over the people. Okay? This is what you all need to know. Okay, with that being said, that's it being that. We're going to let y'all go, okay? Gotta go. Y'all take care. We'll talk in a minute, all right? Goodbye. Adios. Sayonara. Y'all gotta go. Get out of here. I don't want to talk to y'all no more. Bye!